Welcome to the January month Tamil Heritage Trust monthly talk. Can you all hear me? I think there is just 1 second. So I will give a brief introduction about today's speaker. Chitra Madhavan completed her MA and MPhil from the Department of Indian History, University of Madras, and her PhD from the Department of Ancient History and Archaeology, University of Mysore. She is a recipient of 2 postdoctoral fellowships from the Department of Culture, Government of India, and from the Indian Council of Historical Research, New Delhi. She is author of 9 books, History of Culture of Tamil Nadu in 2 volumes, Vishnu Temples of South India in 5 volumes, Sanskrit Education and Literature in Ancient and Medieval Tamil Nadu, an Epigraphical Study, and Temples of Kanchipuram. She has written the text for a coffee table book, Snapshots of a Bygone Era, A Century of Images, which contains about 100 photographs of monuments of India. Chitra has co-edited a book, South Indian Heritage, an Introduction, containing approximately 500 articles on various aspects of the heritage and culture of South India. She has compiled 3 books, one on sculpture for Kalakshetra Foundation, one on the Srirangam Temple, and the third on the Varadaraja Perumal Temple, Kanchipuram. Chitra has contributed about 100 articles on temple architecture and allied subjects to the multi-volume Encyclopedia of Hinduism. She is a guest lecturer at various institutions in Chennai, such as Kalakshetra Foundation, Asian College of Journalism, and Dakshin Chitra. Dr. Chitra's popular heritage walks and her talks, especially on temple architecture, are legendary. For well over a decade, she has single-handedly inspired hundreds, if not thousands, to take up Indian heritage as an area of interest. Over the years, Dr. Chitra has been an integral part of many of PhD's Pechi Kacheri seminars. I would like to thank Dr. Chitra for joining us today as well. Over to Dr. Chitra Madhavan.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rajesh Seshadri, for the introduction. And my humble thanks to Tamil Heritage Trust for inviting me this evening to deliver this lecture on Hampi, on Vijayanagara. My namaskarams, very good evening to the audience. I begin with a shloka in Sanskritam from the Megha Sandesham of Kalidasa, the Uttaramegham part. Niche gachya tuparicha dasha chakrane nikramena, which translates as follows: the cycle of time goes up and down just like a wheel. Nowhere is this more evident than the rise, the glory, and the fall of the empire of Vijayanagara. There is another line also in Sanskritam, not of Kalidasa's but some other author: chakravat parivartante sukhani cha dukhani cha. Happiness and sorrow go around like a cycle. That also is very pertinent for the Vijayanagara Empire. When, how, why, where did this all originate? Our history textbooks, unfortunately, tell us pitifully little about the Vijayanagara Empire at the school, at the college levels. This empire surely deserves better. Surely deserves better. We know when Babur came into India, and that was the same time when Krishnadevaraya was ruling over a mammoth empire, the largest empire in Asia in the medieval times. And precious little do we hear about the Vijayanagara Empire. Isn't that a pity? Isn't that a great pity? So how did this kingdom, which was to become a huge empire, how did it rise? What were the conditions that led to the rise of the Vijayanagara Empire? We all know that in South India, the Cholas were a very formidable power, but they waned and disappeared completely, and we don't hear of them after 1279 CE. And the Pandyas rose to power from their nerve center, Madurai, and they dominated the whole of South India. at that point of time, there was a rivalry in the early part of the 14th century between two brothers of the Pandyan dynasty named Sundara Pandya and Veera Pandya. And Sundara Pandya made the mistake of inviting Alauddin Khilji for help against his brother. Manikafur came here, this is well recorded, in 1310, 1311. And South India was pretty much ravaged. Hot on the heels of the invasion of Manikafur came Ulugh Khan, Muhammad bin Tughlaq to be, in the reign of Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. This was in 1323 CE. And again, South India was invaded, very much plundered and much desecrated. The Sultanate of Madurai was established in 1325 and it lasted up to 1370-71 in and around the Madurai area. In the Andhra Telangana region were the Kakatiyas, and the last ruler, Pratap Rudra, was taken captive by Ulugh Khan and he died on the way to Delhi. The Hoysalas, who were dominant in the South Karnataka area and in parts of Tamil Nadu as well, incidentally, Tiruvannamalai was one of the secondary capitals of the Hoysalas, had dwindled, had become a very, very poor power after the invasion of Ulugh Khan, that is Muhammad bin Tughlaq to be, and they were weakened, completely weakened, but they were still there. And it was up to the Vijayanagara to take over all of the area of the Hoysalas a little later. Therefore, there were no major powers in South India. There was no political stability. There was no economic prosperity. No cultural activities were there at this point of time. There were small powers fighting with each other. And there was anarchy at that point of time. There was a complete vacuum. Now, in 1336 AD, and that is a date to be etched in gold, moreover, etched in our hearts, there was a glorious sunrise, not on the seashore, but on the banks of the river Tungabhadra. Now, again, what led to this sunrise was the fact that two brothers named Harihara and Bukka, traditional accounts, guided by Swami Vidyaranya of the Sringeri Mata, a great scholar, a great preceptor, a seer in the true sense of the word, decided to establish the nucleus of a small kingdom on the banks of the river Tungabhadra. So who were Harihara and Bukka? Harihara's name was Hakka, and they seem, according to some scholars, to have been under the Kakatiya rulers at one point of time. There are other scholars who would say that they were under Hoysala Ballala III. Nevertheless, they were from a place called Kampili, very close to the Hampi of today. And they were the sons, two of the five sons of a person called Sangama. Now here, again, before I start off into the history of Hampi proper, and then we go into the monuments, when we say Vijayanagara dynasty so easily, we actually have to remember that we are dealing with four completely different dynasties. It wasn't just one from the start to finish like we know of other dynasties. Here we have the Sangama dynasty, begun by Harihara and Bukka. And then we have the Saluva, then we have the Tuluva, to which dynasty belonged the illustrious Krishnadevaraya and Achyutaraya. And then we have the Aravidu dynasty. So each of these dynasties, the first three especially, have contributed to the rise and to the phenomenal growth and to the glory of Hampi. Aravidu dynasty, we will come to a little later at the conclusion of this lecture, when we come to the fall of Hampi. Many were the activities of the kings of the first three dynasties, some of which we will look at. I also have to make this disclaimer at the very beginning of this lecture, the fact that I can do absolutely no justice, the fact that I can only skim the surface of the Vijayanagara dynasty in a span of an hour or a little more than an hour. It's a very, very huge topic. My lecture today, this evening, is not meant for scholars. I hope there are more scholars in this audience. It's only meant for those who have a deep love for Indian history, for South Indian history, for Vijayanagara history, and for Hampi. It's only that. Because in the span of an hour or an hour and 15, 20 minutes, there is nothing much more than I can do. So, Harihara, with the help of his younger brother Gupta and with the guidance of Swami Vidyaranya of the Sringeri Mata, established a capital of a small kingdom, which, as I said, was going to become the glorious empire a little later. They established the capital in a place called Anagundi, which is on the northern banks of the river Tungabhadra. But that place, being susceptible to attacks by invaders,
a little bit of noise coming around, and also if you can be a little louder, that'll be great.
Okay.
If you can probably get the mic a little closer, if you could just turn it around. Closer to you.
That I can do. Is this any way better? Is it slightly better?
There is a slight grating external noise coming. I don't know whether it is.
Can we check this?
Can you check the mic connection to the earphone connection to your laptop a little bit?
Yes, and reinserted it. Is this in any way better? And I can be a little louder.
No, it's now certainly better. If the mic, you can just lower it a little bit closer from the current position. That can be rotated slightly. If you could do it lower, that may be probably better. Okay. But yeah, go ahead.
I can do that. Okay, thank you. So, anyway, so the capital was shifted from Anagundi to the south bank of the river Tungabhadra, and prophetically it was named Vijayanagara, the city of victory. And the different dynasties that were to rule over Vijayanagara have been called by historians as the Vijayanagara dynasty. The empire has come to be known as the Vijayanagara empire. So many, many were the kings of this dynasty, as I just mentioned. And the most important being Harihara and Bukka. Harihara the second, Devaraya the first, Devaraya the second, some of whose contributions we will be seeing in the course of this lecture. The throne was taken from the last ruler of the Sangama lineage, Devaraya, by Sadhava Narasimha, an ambitious general, in 1485, thus ending the rule of the Sangama dynasty. And then comes the Saluva dynasty, which was again ended by the Tuluva dynasty that comes into play, of which Krishna Devaraya and Achyutaraya were the most important kings, and who took Vijayanagara to exceedingly great heights. Now, before again we go into further history, we must know how we come to know about. This is an approximate map of the Vijayanagara Empire. This is where Hampi is today in Karnataka, on the banks of the river Tungabhadra. An ancient map, parts of Orissa were also conquered by Krishna Devaraya. The famous crest, the emblem, the logo of the dynasty of Vijayanagara, of the Varaha, with a sword in front, and the sun and the moon, Surya and Chandra on top. This is there in many of their copper plate inscriptions as the seal. And you find this sculpture in many of their temples in Hampi and in various other places across South India as well. And this has been interpreted to mean like Varaha, who bore Goddess Earth and who saved her from the clutches of Hiranyaksha. The Vijayanagara rulers too were going to protect South India as long as the sun and the moon were there, with the power of their arms. Such a powerful emblem was this. And here, I'm just showing you some of the copper plate inscriptions of the Vijayanagara dynasty. This particular one is of the reign of Krishnadevaraya. The language of the inscription is Sanskritam, and the script employed is Kannada, over here, this one, like this. There are many, many such copper plate inscriptions, not to speak of the innumerable hundreds and hundreds of stone inscriptions that adorn the walls of many, many temples. This is one inscription of Krishnadevaraya. This is an inscription of Achyutaraya, Krishnadevaraya's half-brother and successor. And these are called the Unumanjeri plates. In fact, I would think that most people in this audience are from Chennai. So I'll share a very interesting detail about this inscription. This was issued by Achyutaraya from Vijayanagara, that is Hampi of today, when he was on the banks of the river Tungabhadra. It was issued to many scholars in the village of Uhinai. And Uhinai is the Unamanjeri of today, which is on the outskirts of Chennai, very close to Bandalur Zoo. And so many of the inscriptions of the copper plate inscriptions of these kings carry this seal. This is the logo of the Vijayanagara Empire, which I just showed you. Also, the last part, even though the inscription may be in the Nandinagari script, which is the precursor of Devanagari, used in Vijayanagara copper plate inscriptions, the last line was always Sri Virupaksha. I'll show it to you here as well. This is Sri Virupaksha written over here. The reason for this being that these kings, the Vijayanagara kings of the Sangama, Saluva and the Tuluva dynasties, as long as they were ruling from Vijayanagara, that is Hampi, had got Virupaksha as their main deity, their family god, the Kuladevam, and that they were ruling as regents on his behalf. So though an inscription would be issued by Krishnadevaraya or Achyutadevaraya, whoever it may be, it was signed in the name of Sri Virupaksha. That's something very important that you can notice in almost all the copper plate inscriptions of the Vijayanagara rulers. Another very important source of history for the Vijayanagara times are the gold coins. Many of these coins are called the Varahas. There are very many denominations of these gold coins. We also have the accounts of the foreign travelers. This is of unbelievable importance as far as Vijayanagara history is concerned, because we get to know much about the times from their writings, precious writings that they have left behind. So let me give you the names of some of the very important foreign travelers who came to Vijayanagara, who visited this city, who met the kings and have written, waxed eloquent about the greatness of this place, this empire. One of the first to come was a person called Niccolo Conti, circa 1420, an Italian traveler who visited Vijayanagara in the reign of Devaraya the First. And his is the earliest known description of Vijayanagara. Then we have a person called Abdul Razak, 1442 to 1444, he was here in India. In 1443, he was in the city of Vijayanagara, envoy from the court of the Persian king, Shah Rukh. And he made an official visit to Vijayanagara, and he writes, I quote, "The city of Vijayanagara is such that the pupil of the eye has never seen a place like it, and the ear of intelligence has never been informed that there existed anything to equal it in the world," unquote. Then we have Barbosa, 1501, who came with the first Portuguese fleet and traveled to Vijayanagara. He speaks of a king who in all likelihood would be Veera Narasimha Tuluva, the first of the Tuluva dynasty. Then we have Varthema, 1510, an Italian traveler who visited Vijayanagara in the reign of the same king, Veera Narasimha Tuluva. His description of this city was published in Europe in 1510. Domingo Pes, 1520 to 1522, his is by far the most extensive account of the Vijayanagara Empire. It's huge, full of details about every aspect of Vijayanagara's history. Incidentally, he was from Portugal, as the name suggests, and he was a horse trader. The Vijayanagara rulers bought a number of horses for their armies from the Portuguese, who were the horse traders, and who had taken on this role from the Arabs, who were trading in horses earlier. Nunes, 1535-37, again a Portuguese horse trader, came in the reign of Achyutaraya to Vijayanagara. Finally, in circa 1567, After the fateful battle of Tagikota, you have Frederici, an Italian traveler who spent 7 months in Vijayanagara after it was sacked, after it was virtually destroyed. And this is a mention, I'll talk about it later, but again, I'll mention it now. He says that Tirumala of the Aravidu dynasty, after they had left Vijayanagara, after they had fled after the fateful battle of Tagikota, attempted to re-establish his capital here. And the descriptions of Hampi by this foreign traveler were translated into English in 1588. So these are the very important sources left behind by the foreign travelers. Incidentally, we have indigenous sources as well, of course, like the Kamparaya Charitram, which is also called Madhura Vijayam by Ganga Devi, who was a wife of Prince Kumara Kampanna, son of Bhukka the First, who completely put an end to the Sultanate of Madurai, and because of which the Vijayanagara Empire spread up to Kanyakumari and the whole of Tamil Nadu came under the jurisdiction of the Vijayanagara emperors. You also have very many archaeological excavations. And before I forget, we must know that this wonderful city of Vijayanagara was the ancient Kishkinda of Ramayana fame. If you, all of you are familiar with the Valmiki Ramayana, you will understand that Kishkinda of the Kishkinda Kanda of the Valmiki Ramayana has been beautifully described by Valmiki, and this was the Kishkinda, the present day Hampi. Now, there is something called local tradition which none of us should forget. Nowhere else in India is any place so associated with that particular chapter, the Kishkinda Kandam of the Valmiki Ramayana, as is present-day Hampi. You have here today a place that will show you a Sugriva's cave. You have the Rishimukha Hill. You have the Matanga Parvata, the Matanga Hill on which sage Matanga meditated, and he saw to it that Bali was cursed and he couldn't stay over there. You have the Kodandarama temple near the Tungabhadra River where Lakshmana is said to have crowned Sugriva. Each and every place resonates, it echoes from the Kishkinda Kanda of the Valmiki Ramayana. Plus, the flora and the fauna given by Valmiki in this particular chapter they tally with what we see in Hampi of today. So this was definitely the ancient Kishkinda. The number of Ramayana sculptures that you find here, the importance given to Hanuman, especially one form of Hanuman called Veera Hanuman, which we will see a little later, are all also over here. We'll just go to some of the sites and we'll go through with the history with the help of these pictures. I'm just showing you this particular temple for a certain reason. This is called the Chandrasekhara temple, completely ruined. And there is no deity there. You can walk in with your footwear on like you can in many of the temples of Hampi. But if you look at this Gopuram, if you look at this Mantapam, and if you look at this Vimanam, you could think that you are in some village or town or city in Tamil Nadu. This completely and totally conforms to the style of architecture that you find in this region and in some other places around Tamil Nadu as well. Now, why did the Vijayanagara kings or their architects, sculptors, their engineers decide to follow this type of architecture, which is famously known as the Dravidian style of temple architecture? Badami, the capital of the Chalukyas, is only about, say, 3 hours by road from present-day Hampi. Hoysala temples have also been found in parts of Hampi. It was part of their jurisdiction before Harihara and Bhukka made it their capital.
Chitra Salimi.
Yes.
Just 1 second. Are you by any chance playing YouTube on one of your windows connected?
No, not at all.
Okay, because we're still getting some echo.
Oh, no, I'm not.
Okay, you know, your voice is still, you know, it was better after I interviewed a little bit. Sorry about this.
If no,
you
could, no.
We're still getting
it's
some.
Again now, is it?
Yeah, it's gone down a little bit, but also there is a little disturbing noise coming from elsewhere.
I have no idea what that could be, but if you will just give me a second, I'll switch off the fan and maybe that's contributing to it.
Yeah, if you could, please.
Yeah, just give me a second, please.
Also, you you can also try without the earphones, but let us just try it now.
Okay. Can you tell me how this is now?
It certainly seems to be better.
Okay, I'll talk for a few minutes, and then you let me know whether it's okay. Otherwise, I'll remove the earphone and speak without it.
Yeah. Okay. Please continue. Okay. Sorry.
No, not an issue at all. So, the stone in Hampi is mostly granite, and the style of architecture of Tamil Nadu is mostly of granite. This is one of the reasons why this style of architecture was adopted instead of that of the Hoysalas, which is of soft stone or chloritic schist, which you cannot replicate in granite. So that is the reason why you have temples of granite following the Dravidian style of temple architecture, predominantly seen in the Tamil Nadu area over here. So the sculptures, some of the sculptures in the Chandrasekhara temple nearby, very many ruined temples, which I am not going into the details of now. One of the entrances of the grand city of Hampi, we go to the Virupaksha temple or the Pampapati temple, the best known, the one that is very, very actively in worship. Many temples, most temples in Hampi are in a ruined condition, as most of you are aware. There are a few temples that are still in worship, of which the best known is the Virupaksha temple, which is situated on the banks of the river Tungabhadra. From this photograph and from the previous one, we understand that the Tungabhadra snakes its way around one side of Hampi through others, and then the rest of the city of Hampi is ringed by hills, which is also a natural, very, very natural fortification. This Tungabhadra River has been glorified in this work called the Madhurabhijayam, which I had mentioned, was written by Ganga Devi, wife of Kumara Kampanna. Very beautifully, she says, and I quote, Suralokanta Sankranta Swarnadiva Saradiva Parika Karatam Yantya Parita Tungabhadraya. Meaning, as if in rivalry with the heavenly Ganga that flowed around the borders of Swargaloka, the river Tungabhadra encircled the city of Vijayanagara as a formidable moat. Perfect. It was a moat through which invaders could not come, across which invaders could not come, and then the hills of Hampi as well, many, many of the hills of Hampi. So this Virupaksha temple was there as the Pampapati temple far before Harihara made it the capital in 1336 AD. And then this Virupaksha became the family deity of the Vijayanagara emperors. This place was called Pampa Tirtha, Pampapura. It was a completely Shaivite settlement. And among the Vijayanagara kings, it was Devaraya II of the 15th century who transformed this temple into a huge complex by building the gopurams, the high enclosure wall, the chariot street in front, donating huge chariots to this temple. It is at the base of the famous Hemakuta Hill is the Virupaksha temple dedicated to Shiva. So here is the best known gopuram of Hampi, at the base of which you have many, many sculptures. We'll come to sculptures from other temples a little later. This is Markandeya hugging the Shivalinga, a very well-known story episode in Tamil Nadu and here in Hampi as well. So Hampi has huge boulders. There is a Tungabhadra by the side. As you enter this temple, on the ceiling of the mantapa that is right in front, you have this very well-known painting of Swami Vidyaranya. It belongs to the Vijayanagara times, but it seems to have been painted on in later times as well. Now, Swami Vidyaranya was a person whom many generations of Vijayanagara kings were grateful to. And he is known from many, many inscriptions as well. Now, there is one particular inscription that not many people know about. It is very interesting. Though Harihara's inscriptions are also there about Swami Vidyaranya, the inscription that I'm going to mention to you now is from a lesser known ruler of the Sangama dynasty called Virupaksha. And this is the esteem in which The Vijayanagara rulers held the Swami Vidyaranya. This inscription is found in Tamil Nadu in the Ranganatha Swami temple, and it mentions Virupaksha's disenchantment with worldly life and his visit to Swami Vidyaranya. And I'm just quoting the English translation for you. There was a turmoil in the mind of this noble king. At one time, seeing the grave troubles and torments undergone by beings passing everlastingly through the cycle of birth, death, and rebirth, and moved by the deepest compassion for them, he approached and prostrated himself before his own preceptor, the refuge of the whole world, namely Paramahamsa Parivrajakacharya Vidyaranya Sripada, who was the most distinguished of all ascetics, vision of whom was easy to the virtuous, whose mind was always engaged in meditation, involving the self and the soul, who was like Shankaracharya incarnate. He then realized that without serving at the holy feet of this enlightened soul, he could not hope to get rid of hotier born of shortcomings attributable to the body, the mind, and speech, and that he could not hope to see the dispelling of darkness, that is spiritual ignorance, and that he could not hope to achieve that spiritual height that would yield him the fruit of the four requisites of human existence. It is known that Virupaksha crowned himself immediately after the death of Harihara II, but was displaced after a short period by Dukha II. And this spirit of disenchantment and his realization that salvation lay only in the service of sage Vidyaranya, as revealed by this inscription, may have made Virupaksha's exit from the throne voluntary. So this was one instance where a king gave up everything, abdicated, and went to the feet, fell at the feet of Swami Vidyaranya. There are other sources also to show the part played by this preceptor, of this erudite preceptor from the Sringeri Matha, in the formation and guidance of the kings of the Vijayanagara Empire. So these are some of the paintings that you find on the ceiling of the mantapa of the Virupaksha temple. These are all very, very nice paintings and preserved by the Archaeological Survey of India, Marriage of Shiva and Parvati, etc. Typical Vijayanagara format in with the borders very clearly seen over here. So these are, this is Manmatha aiming his bana, his arrow at Shiva. Now coming back to the Virupaksha temple, there are shrines inside of which belong prior or much prior to the Vijayanagara times. The whole of it enclosed by a compound wall, gopurams added, and this deity became the family deity, and the kings of this dynasty ruled as his regents, as I have already stated. In front of the gopuram of the Virupaksha temple is a huge road. This is the chariot road. The marketplace of the Vijayanagara times is very, very well known. There were marketplaces in many parts of this very, very big city. In front of many of the temples, they were there. Now, when you go to the accounts of the foreign travelers, they'll also mention how crowded this city was. For example, I'm quoting Domingos Pais. He says, I quote, "The size of the city, I do not write here, because it cannot all be seen from any one spot. But I climbed a hill where I could see a great part of it. What I saw from there seemed to me as large as Rome and very beautiful to the sight." He also mentions, the same foreign traveler mentions, that it was the best provided city in the world, talking about its marketplaces. Looking at this road so forlorn now, just look at this. We cannot understand how it was at one point of time. It was, I mean, so, so very crowded. He says, "The people in this city are countless in number, so much so that I do not wish to write that down for fear that it should be thought fabulous. But I declare that no troops, horses, or foot could break their way through any street or lane, so great are the numbers of the people and elephants." So what was sold in these marketplaces? What was available? Again, coming to our rescue are the foreign travelers who mentioned a variety of vegetables, fruit, meat, diamonds, pearls, emeralds, silks, velvets, brocades from various places, including Turkey, China, and Persia. Have any of these things been found? No, but only a few gold chains, fragments of Chinese porcelain from the 16th century Ming era have been found. Only the colonnades of the streets in front of the temple stand today. Many parts of Hampi stand forlorn, but this was how the city was, buzzing with activity and selling almost everything that was possible to be found from many, many parts of the world. Here you have a picture of Hampi where it is very, very green. There are parts of Hampi that are completely barren because of the rocks. But you see, this river Tungabhadra, which was vying with the river Ganga that flowed in the heavens, as Ganga Devi in the Madhura Vijayam says, was there. And she, this river, was a huge source of water supply for this city. So we'll see that Hampi was full of orchards. Again, foreign travelers coming to our rescue, and mostly irrigated fields were there. Many of them supplying so many edibles to the city of Hampi. The reason for that was mainly this river Tungabhadra. Hampi, and I will show it to you later in the pictures, but I'll talk about it now in association with the Tungabhadra. It had a very elaborate network of water bodies. Water supply had to be ensured for the multitudes of people living in Hampi, and also because army was also stationed here along with the animals. And since
Can you make it full screen? The audio is fine. The image will be larger.
This is full screen.
Perfect. Yeah, thanks.
Welcome. All right. So the rivers, the waters of the Tungabhadra flowed through hills, and they flowed through ridges. Dams were built, channels were dug to irrigate the fields and also bring the water to various parts of Hampi. The Vijayanagara records mention hydraulic schemes, and Krishnadevaraya even invited Portuguese engineers to build dams and tanks, etc. So that was to do with the river Tungabhadra. On the other side, you have a place called Kamalapura, which is very well known to people visiting Hampi today. And the Kamalapura tank is a main source of water, was the main source of water for the city's royal center. And this was carried through channels, over ground, terracotta pipes, aqueducts. I'll show you pictures of aqueducts later, to the royal bath, and many of the water bodies that was in the, I repeat, city's royal centers. The temple tanks, there were so many temples, and almost all of them had temple tanks, were also used for harvesting water. And even today, there is a channel called Hiriya Kaluvai, also known as Turutu, Turta. It is still active, showing you how many channels were there in this city of Hampi, making it very, very, very green. So this is the rocky part of Hampi, and next to it, you can see a huge orchard, and this is the chariot road of the Virupaksha temple. This is an old picture that I have for you. And at the end of this road, you have a huge monolithic nandi, sadly mutilated, which is the nandi of the Virupaksha temple. And this is the road, pictures taken many years ago, which was the main marketplace of this city. On the Hemakuta hill, next to which is situated the Virupaksha temple, you have some monuments of the Hoysala times that are prior to 1336, when the Vijayanagara empire was established over here. Very clearly, completely different type of architecture that you see from that of the Vijayanagara temples. That's the Hemakuta hill. We'll visit the Hemakuta hill at least a couple more times by the end of this lecture. The river Tungabhadra, this is scenic. If you don't like history, if you don't like architecture, if you don't like sculpture, if you're not conversant with Hindu tradition, the stories of the Ramayana, Mahabharata, still visit Hampi. Go to Hampi anyways, because it's so very beautiful. I'm just showing you some of the natural beauty, the landscape of Hampi. We'll get back to the monuments a little later. This is the river Tungabhadra in full flow. This is how people have crossed it for centuries and are still crossing it today. These coracles, which are so, so strong that they can hold these many and even more motorcycles, and you cross the Tungabhadra very safely onto the other side. So this is how the river looks in the summer months when there isn't much water, and there are also the reflections of some of the ancient hills mentioned in the Ramayana over here. There are fortifications, natural like this and man-made like this, around Hampi. The seven concentric enclosures made of stone and earth put together. And these were what prevented the invaders from coming in for many, many centuries. In the middle of the river Tungabhadra, you have mandapams like this, which served as rest houses for people coming in from far away. This is something that you will see along the Tungabhadra wherever you turn. And a variety of flora and fauna. All this. It's a bird lover's paradise as well. I am not going through the temples in any particular order. I am really very stressed for time. So what we are going to do is to go around Hampi in any which way. Now here we are going to the Achyutaraya temple, the name of which is after a king. That's how it is locally called today. If you want to go to this temple, you will have to call it the Achyutaraya temple. It is, inscriptions mention that the original name was Thiruvengada Natha, Venkateshwara, because from the start of the Tuluva dynasty, Krishnadevaraya and his brother Achyutaraya in particular, the great devotees of Lord Venkateshwara of Tirumala. And for that one reason, there was a lot of Vaishnavism in the city of Vijayanagara in the time of these rulers. Not that it was not there earlier, and not that it was not there immediately after also. So this was built in, this temple was built in 1534, 31 years before the fall of Vijayanagara. It was not constructed by King Achyutaraya, though it bears his name today. It was constructed by Tirumalaraya Vodayar in the reign of Achyutaraya. He was a nephew of Achyutaraya and also the brother of his queen, Bharadambika. The marketplace, there was a huge, this is the road that you're seeing in front of this temple, is the marketplace road, which was once very, very crowded, selling a huge number of commodities. It was called Achyutaraya Peta. And in course of time, over time, it got the name Sule Bazaar or the Courtesan's Street. It is mentioned like that in many of the accounts of the foreign travelers. Hardly anything of this temple is seen today. It is very close to the famous hillock in the center of Hampi, Matanga Hill. Unfortunately, burnt down, and hardly anything, as I said, survives of it today. We move to the Vithala temple, which is one of the most famous temples over here on the banks of the river Tungabhadra. Vithala, the god of Pandharpur, as you all know in Karnataka, is a very famous deity over there, drawing lakhs of devotees to it every year. Many of the kings of the Vijayanagara dynasty were devotees of Lord Vithala, and therefore, in the reign of King Devaraya, this temple came to be built. But it was extensively added to in the reign of Krishnadevaraya, with the gopurams being contributed to by the queens of Krishnadevaraya, literally on the banks of River Tungabhadra, as you can see in this photograph. So that was in front of the Vithala temple. You can see the Bazaar Street, and this is how the layout of the Vithala temple is today. It was not a very, very large temple, moderate in size, and this is the Bazaar Road in front of it, forlorn today, but again, mentioned in many of the accounts. So we right at the in the background over there, you can see Anjanadri. This place, Hampi, is totally connected with, as I am repeating, the Ramayana and Hanuman. And it is the temple, and this is the hillock on top of which is a small temple. This is where Anjana Devi is said to have given birth to Hanuman. You can see a path that snakes its way up this hill. Anyway, the sad and forlorn condition of some of the gopurams of the Vithala temple, as you see it today, having been burnt down at one point of time. But we can't attribute everything to 1565 when Hampi was attacked by many of the armies of the Deccanese Sultans. It appears that the Vithala temple was in worship a little after the debacle that happened in 1565 also. So this is how the gopuras look. And you can clearly see the brick that is inside over there. The base of all the temple gopurams are granite. The superstructure are in brick and in stucco. And these are some of the sculptures that you will see at the base over here of one of the gopurams of the Vithala temple, the Matsyavatara. And I hasten to add that the portraiture of the Matsya and the Kurma avatars of Vishnu become very, very popular from the Vijayanagara times in stone sculpture. So Vishnu and Lakshmi, Garuda on one side, Hanuman on the other. And we go into the premises of the Vithala temple, where we see the famous stone chariot of Hampi. In many places I have read, and I have also heard, that this is a monolith. That's completely wrong. This is made of many, many stones, but such a grand thing as this one has never seen. This is actually the Garuda sanctum, inside which is Garuda still, and facing the main sanctum of Vithala, which is unfortunately completely dilapidated, and there is no Vithala inside now. This is how it looked, this sanctum. And I have scanned this photograph from a book of the Alkazi collection, and this is photograph was taken in 1856, and this is how it looked with the superstructure, which is unfortunately missing today, having been made of brick and stucco and having become dilapidated and disappeared. So these are some of the old photographs of the Vithala temple and the forlorn condition it was in. Now today we see that this chariot is being pulled by elephants. However, there are pieces of evidence to show that horses once pulled this chariot, and right behind elephants you can also see the tail of a horse even today. This is Garuda inside this stone chariot and looking on at Vithala, who is no more there in form. But on the walls of this stone chariot you can see a small sculpture of Vithala as he was in the main sanctum, arms akimbo there like this, and lots of other sculptures as well, traces of paintings. The base is like this, and the elephants that are seen to be pulling this Garuda Mantapam, this Garuda Sanctum today. The wheels have been absolutely brilliantly carved, and it is said that they could once rotate in their given place, but no more do they rotate now. But what fantastic carving this is. The Mantapa of this temple is something awesome. And you know, you can actually see the intricate carving on the ceiling. And this is a whole row of Kolatam dancers over here carved on the ceiling. A lot of hard work has gone into putting this into granite. Vithala is Krishna, and there are lots of Krishna sculptures here. Manmatha over here. The pillars are chock full of sculptures typical of the Vijayanagara era. Rama family as well. And these are some of the old pictures to give us an idea of how it must once have looked before it became a tourist site, a UNESCO World Heritage Center, cared for by the Archaeological Survey of India, and some temples, some places by the Karnataka State Department of Archaeology. So this is how the inside of the Mantapa of the Vithala temple looks. Now let us quickly, very quickly, for short of time, go and visit the main sanctum. This is the Vimanam, which is kind of intact, and on it we will see many sculptures of Krishna. Here you have the Kalina Nartana Krishna, Vishnu here with consorts Sri Devi and Bhudevi, Govardhana Giridhari Krishna. The cows are still to be seen. This is Vithala. You can see him with the arms akimbo, like this, as we saw in the temple chariot and many of the other ceilings of the mantapas also. We have here a small sculpture of Hanuman as Veera Hanuman. Very, very Vijayanagara is this Veera Hanuman. You hardly see him before that, much, much seen after the Vijayanagara times, walking forward, one hand held up in Abhaya Hasta in blessing, tail going completely over his head, and the other hand holding a stalk of a lotus bud. This we will see in many, many places in Hampi and in various other places also. The famous musical pillars of Hampi, when tapped, this is made of resonant stone, and when tapped, they emit the Saptaswaras in the Vitala temple and in so many other places in Tamil Nadu, starting from the Vijayanagara and the Nayak times. There's a Pushkarini, there's a temple tank over here. Sometimes we miss this temple tank when we go to this temple. These were some of the water bodies of the grand Vijaya city of Vijayanagara to store water in the hot summer months. We visit the Hazara Rama temple, a 15th century temple, something temple that is amazing for more reasons than one, almost completely constructed of granite. This is the entrance. The no sculptures, no images of Rama and his family inside the main sanctum. Like I said, you can go in with your footwear on. But why this is called Hazara Rama Temple, when originally called as Ramachandra, is because of the numerous sculptures of the Ramayana that you see on the walls. The main Ramayana and then the Uttara Ramayana are also carved on the main shrine and on the ancillary ones as well. So let us, this is the main sanctum, as I explained, nothing in there at all. And then the Ramayana starts from here with Shravan Kumar carrying his aged blind parents. He's hung them up on a tree, gone to fetch water for them. King Dasharatha, and look how very nicely this sculptor has put a tree in front of Dasharatha to show that he is of royalty. There is a person holding an umbrella over his head, seemed to be holding an umbrella over his head. Dasharatha, not seeing who is there, has shot an arrow, and next instance, it pierces the heart of Shravan Kumar and he is dying. Then we come to the Putra Kameshti Yaga. Here you see Shreya Rishi Shringa with the face of a deer performing this sacrifice for Dasharatha to beget children. These are the three wives of Dasharatha. And then the divinity that arose from the sacrificial fire giving the payasam, prasadam, to the three queens. The children are born, being tutored by Vasishta. It just goes on. I'm skipping many things. And this is Sita seeing the golden deer, Maricha. Rama going after the golden deer. Note, the bow is like this, as he didn't intend killing the deer, but only to capture him for his beloved Sita. And then as Rama shoots the arrow, Maricha emerges from being a deer into a Rakshasa. The imagination of these sculptors. I am going back and forth, but this is a little known episode from the Valmiki Ramayana of Rama killing Kabanda, who had his head inside his stomach. Everything down to the greatest detail. Ravana abducting Sita is here, and the killing of Jatayu is here. Rama giving moksha to Jatayu is also portrayed. Hanuman's meeting with Rama. Note the size of Hanuman here, his importance as far as Kishkindha is concerned. Hanuman first came as an ascetic, and then he became his usual self after meeting Rama and Lakshmana. And this is Rama piercing the arrow through the Saptasala, or the seven trees, to prove who he was to Sugriva. And this is not from the Valmiki Ramayana. The fight of Vali and Sugriva over here, hands interlocked, legs interlocked, and Vali's death with his head on the lap of his wife Tara and his young son Angada nearby. And just three lines over here and fish underneath to show that Hanuman is crossing over to Lanka. Just that. So simple. A meeting with Sita, meeting with Ravana, and back to Kishkindha and his meeting with Rama. Everything is there. And the crossing of the monkey army to Lanka, the war, many, many war scenes, And finally, Rama and Ravana fighting, the Yuddha, and Ravana's death. So this is how the entire series of panels, Ravana is gone over here. Rama worshipping in Rameshwaram is also a portrait. The Pattabhisheka is also there. And this is how the walls of this temple actually look, completely and totally chock-a-block. But when you enter the temple, the stone is different. This is dolerite, and very delicate carvings are found here on this softer stone. Like, again, Krishna with four arms holding the Shankar Chakra is a very Vijayanagara thing with Rukmini and Satyabhama. Other sculptures also in other parts of the temple, very, very typically of the Vijayanagara times. Wrestling was very much there. The foreign travelers tell us about the wrestling competitions that were there, very interesting accounts and everything. This is elephant country also, so you have much to do with elephants as well. Now we go look at this. Jewelers should visit Hampi to take patterns for them. And inscriptions giving you details of this temple. I know I'm going a bit fast, but I need to. Peera Hanuman sculpture here as well. And the outer compound wall of this temple is something else. Amazingly beautiful, because it doesn't have any religious sculptures, but it's like photographs of Hampi from the Vijayanagara times. These are the Portuguese coaxing, cajoling, pushing, prodding, pulling the horses. You can see the beard, you can see the attire of these Portuguese horse traders, and they made huge, huge profits. From Goa they came, made huge profits selling horses to the Vijayanagara army, and camels as well. We know that they were beasts of burden. They were used by drummers to proclaim many things. Elephants, of course, part of that. This is how the soldiers were, the kind of dress they wore, the kind of weapons they used, the way they fought. Everything is there. Long flutes, drums, the silambu yuddham, kolatam dancers, the court of the king, and dancers and musicians in front. What have you? Everything that you need is there. And this is a Deepa Stambha, which is in front of this temple. Now, coming to the reign of Krishnadevaraya of the Tuluva dynasty, all of us know that he was the greatest king of the Vijayanagara Empire, etc. Little do we know that parts of Odisha were also conquered by him. There is a place called Udayagiri, which had a formidable fort, which was under the Vijayanagara kings, but it had slowly slipped away. And Krishnadevaraya wanted to make certain that it came back to this empire. And so he took a huge force, went to Odisha, conquered Udayagiri, took hold of that fort. And there he saw an image of Balakrishna, brought it with him all the way from Odisha to his capital Vijayanagara, and got it enshrined in this temple for Krishna that he built in commemoration of his victory over the Gajapati rulers of Orissa. So this Krishna temple stands forlorn today. There is absolutely no worship. There is no image of Krishna inside today. Where is that Krishna now? This is how he looks. And this was taken from the debris around this temple. And it is now in the government museum in Chennai. He's there in one corner. Visitors who come here don't see it. People who go to Hampi don't know where that Krishna is. He's there in Chennai very safely. And the area around this temple was called Krishnapura. It was a township, and this was a very, very Vaishnavite township. Just like the Virupaksha temple surroundings were a very Shaivite township, and the Hemakuta Hill is kind of a dividing line between the Shaivite and the Vaishnavite settlements. There's a grand chariot street in front of the Krishna temple. And there was also a marketplace about which there is a lot of information called Krishna Pete. And there's a Loka Pavani tank in front. Now, what makes this temple very different, for long does it stand today, is the Gopuram that we see in front. An old picture is over here. And this Gopuram has sculptures of armies, hardly gods and goddesses. You can see horses, you can see foot soldiers, you can see the shields and the weapons that they carry. It's like this, because this temple was built to commemorate Krishnadevaraya's victory over the rulers of Orissa. And that is why this temple was built, and that is why the sculptures here are very unique. You have the usual Vijayanagara entrance ways with Ganga Devi on one side and Yamuna Devi on the other, as though we are washing ourselves in the waters of these two rivers and cleansing ourselves and then entering the sacred space of the temple. Above the, I'm not showing it to you for want of time, but above Ganga and Yamuna are like creepers going up, and you see the Dashavatara carved over there in each one of these rounds, which are made by the creepers, the Lata. So this is the Krishna temple, parts of it, completely dilapidated, very, very spacious temple complex is over here. And some of the sculptures, the typical Yali of the Vijayanagara times, Krishna over here, not of great workmanship, but nevertheless, it's a very, very historic temple. We cannot do without Ramayana sculptures in any of the temples of Hampi. Yoga Narsimha, Garuda, again, Veera Hanuman makes his presence felt over here. Musicians and dancers, we learn a lot about the ornaments, the musical instruments, the attire, so much over here. All this is part of the Krishna temple complex, and an inscription giving you the details about why this temple came to be created. I'm just skipping, if you don't mind, a few slides, as I am very aware that I have to complete this in another half an hour at least. We go to some of the monolithic sculptures of Hampi. Hampi is very, very rocky. And in situ, the word means there itself. Wherever they found a rock in Hampi, like the Nandi that I showed you in front of the Virupaksha temple, here also there's a 4.5 meter high rock chiseled into a Ganesha, unfortunately badly damaged today. This is how this colossal image of Ganesha is, one of the biggest in India, and then a temple built around it. And the pillars of the mandapa contain many sculptures of Ganesha. There's a smaller one, not very small, but compared to that 4.5 meter one, it's only 2.4 meters, made in 1506 on top of the Hemakuta hill, close to which is the Virupaksha temple. And this was made, as this plaque says, in memory of King Narasimha by a trader belonging to Chandragiri. Chandragiri was the last bastion of the Vijayanagara rulers. And here is this lovely 2.5 meter high Ganesha. Note his chubby feet and the chubby toes and the naga that he wears as a belt. Also notice, see, the sculptor could have clearly not made these holes. That also very difficult to make in granite between the ear and the shoulders. This is how the Ganesha looks in profile. The next one we have is a 6.7 meter high image of Lakshmi Narasimha from the reign of Krishnadevaraya. The details of who consecrated it, a priest named Krishna Bhatta, is also shown, is also mentioned in an inscription nearby. It was in 1528 AD, made of, needless to say, one piece of stone and a compound wall built, and this was a temple in active worship. So on this slab is that inscription which gives you all the details about this sculpture. Now here, right from that Kirti Mukha that is on top, the hoods of Adisesha, this entire image down to the pedestal, needless to say, is one piece of stone. This was a unique image of Yoga Lakshmi Narasimha, with Lakshmi having been here on his knee. You can still see her arm going around to his back, and the Yoga Patta or the Yoga Bandha indicates that he is in the yogic stance. And this is how the image is viewed from the back. There is a gap between the wall and Adisesha over here, who acts as a canopy around him. There is a huge gap. Look at the dexterity of this sculptor, plus the very, if I may be allowed to say this, manicured hand of Lakshmi nails, cuticles and all, with a beautiful bracelet and all other kind of jewels. Look at the number of rings she wears, placed very delicately on the back of Narasimha. We don't see the Lakshmi today. Her sculpture is not there, it's broken. Now this Narasimha once held the Shankha and Chakra and the bow and the arrow, pieces of which were found in the debris around this, but this is how it looked. This again is a scanned picture from the book of Al-Kazi collection. Narasimha looked like this, bereft of all arms, legs, yoga patta, Lakshmi, etc. This was not done in the battle of 1565 or the destruction that happened to Hampi after 1565. This happened later. I've taken it from this book. I've scanned it from this book. And then later, this Yoga Lakshmi Narasimha was put together again, though not wholly. Very close to this Yoga Lakshmi Narasimha is a 3 meters tall Shiva Linga like this. It's called the Badavi Linga today. And set in a small stream like this, again made of one piece of stone. So these are some of the huge monoliths in this city of Hampi. While all the temples conform to the Agamas and they were built according to the way they should have been constructed, in the 15th century, we have something belonging to the Hindu-Islamic style of architecture. And these are the famous elephant stables of Hampi. Notice the arches and notice the domes. And though there are some scholars who would not agree that these were elephant stables, and there are people who have voiced their view that these may have been some of the offices of the various departments in the administration of the Vijayanagara kings, yet I think most people are agreed that these are the elephant stables of Hampi. The domes are not of a uniform pattern. There are 3 different types over here, as you can see, and built of granite and stucco on top. Thankfully, hardly damaged. Notice the perfection of these domes. And this is an arch between one room and the other. And this is how the ceiling looks. In case elephants were bored and they looked up, they could see such a nice design. And if the elephants looked out, they could see this as well. Then we come to something very spectacular, which is so unique to Hampi. This is not just an arch. This is the Tulabhara Mantapa, where the Tulabhara, which we see being done in so many famous temples today, like in Tirumala and in Guruvayur, where a person weighs himself against an equal amount of, say, rice or jaggery or sugar, and then donates it to the temple. The kings of ancient India were used to doing the Tulabhara. It is one of the 16 Mahadanas or very great charities that they did. Go Sahasra, etc. They are listed in many inscriptions and they are there in the ancient Sanskrit texts as well. So one of the Mahadanas was the Tulabhara or the Tulapurusha. Here you have 3 pieces of stone, one here and the horizontal bar. We'll go nearby and we'll see how this is. I'll just show you a close-up. On the horizontal bar up there, you have this loop of stone, obviously, and part of that beam itself. And then over here, with the marks on it. And then this is the center one. So the loop, and it's made like a small vimanam up there. The loop would typical Vijayanagara lions adorning the top, and sculptures of a Vijayanagara king and his consorts. And this is how it looks. So I'll just go back to the previous pictures. The loop would go into this. And there would hang the chains. And a Vijayanagara king on his birthday or during the coronation or during some auspicious event would weigh himself against an equal amount of very precious things, gold, silver, precious stones, and give them away in charity to temple and to the deserving. So this is something that we need to pay attention to, because we don't find this structure, to the best of my knowledge, in any other part of India. Again, we go to another very beautiful structure, the Lotus Mahal, also called the Chitrangini Mahal, 16th century of the Indo-Islamic style of architecture. The ground story and the upper story, with staircases leading to the upper story. And this was something very beautiful. combining two different types of architecture, with the arches being what they are in is the Islamic style. The Zanana enclosure is again something that is very famous over here, and this is for the royal ladies over here. Part of this has now become a museum. These are the watchtowers from which the security guarded this enclosure. We now go to another famous part of Hampi. This is the Mahanavami Dibba. The foreign travelers who came here couldn't stop talking about it, including Abdul Razak, the envoy of Shah Rukh, the king of Persia, and Domingo Pais, who visited this place in the 15th and 16th centuries. This is how it looks. Completely colossal. From the front, it looks like this. From the side, it's like this. It was built in several stages. Some of the outer stones are not granite. They are chloritic schist, and they have been carved in detail. This is the rear entrance with a flight of stairs leading to the top. This is where royalty must have sat to view the parade that happened during the Mahanavami, or the 9 days leading to Dashara, when the might of the Vijayanagara Empire was showcased over here. And this is the view that you have from the Mahanavami Dibba. Many archaeological excavations that are happening. We see some of the sculptures around this. Kolatam dancers, obviously, this was a very, very popular performance over here. You have camels, you have horses, you have elephants. You have also many, many, this is chloritic schist, as you see here, the stone. Look at this elephant fight. Elephants charging against each other, tusks locked, and this is how they fight. They were trained to fight. The court of the king, with feudatories possibly, or ministers standing in front. Again, marching of elephants. Oh, all that you have, the training, capturing of elephants. Again, king and his courtiers, wrestlers. Once again, we look at them here. Dancers, look at the costume and see how different it was 500 years back in South India, if there are dancers in the audience. Okay, so many types of musical instruments that we have, performances, camel riders, and possibly Turks from Central Asia, as scholars have identified them, many, many, many inside the Mahanavami Dibba over here. So many people visited Vijayanagara from various, various parts of the world, from Portugal to Central Asia. They were all there. So this is of then Portuguese, again with horses. These are the Portuguese horse traders. Much importance is given because horses were an integral part of the Vijayanagara Empire to fight with their main enemies, the Bahmani Sultans. Incidentally, the Bahmani Sultanate splintered into 5 different states at one point of time. There were Ahmednagar, Golconda, Bijapur, Bidar, and Berar. We'll come to that in some amount of detail a little later. The famous water bodies of Hampi, this is the octagonal tank, which must have had a fountain in front, fed by the tank from Kamalapura. This is after all in the royal zone. The Queen's Bath, which is also of the Indo-Islamic style of architecture, though called the Queen's Bath, perhaps according to some archaeologists, scholars, it was used by noble men and their wives. And this is how the corridor around it looks. And the ceiling over here with stucco work, it must have looked splendid when it was made. So the steps leading to the bath as such. And the view from here. Now, we now go to the royal bath. This is again one of the other water bodies of Vijayanagar. And forlorn, it stands today, but must have been the center of much activity. This we cannot miss when we come to Hampi. And people who had gone there 20, 25 years ago wouldn't have seen it because it was covered with mud and sand. The steps being made of schist. This is the famous water tank in Hampi. Please note, while we get carried away by the beauty of these steps, what we should be looking at are the water ducts, the overhead water ducts that poured water into this tank. So this is how it is. When there's very little water, it looks beautiful. When it's full, unfortunately, we miss seeing the beauty of the architecture. So these are the water ducts which I had mentioned at the beginning of the lecture. Now, these are from Rome, and these are from Hampi. This is how it looks. Major, major thing that we see today, and how hydraulics were used. Other parts of Hampi that stand completely forlorn, either damaged or they were not built. As you go along the river Tungabhadra, you can see one Anantashayi Vishnu, another person from Vijayanagara times. These watch houses here and there, everywhere a Hanuman, a Veera Hanuman in painting, a Veera Hanuman casually carved into a slab right by the river Tungabhadra. All this is very much part of Hampi. Stray mantapas like this over here for travelers to use as rest houses when they came into the city, traveling long distances. Forlorn roads today, but once packed with people on the banks of the river Tungabhadra. We are here now. And again, many, many rest houses. That's the Anjanadri that you see on top, very close to the river Tungabhadra. This we should not miss. A very few slides left, I'll be done with it. This is the Purandara Mantapa. Purandara Dasa, one of the greatest composers of Carnatic music, known as the Pitamaha of Carnatic music, lived in the Vijayanagara times, visited Hampi, and this is a place where he composed, and this is known as the Purandara Mantapa. Palace of Veera Harihara. I know I'm exceeding time, but I'll definitely be done soon. How come we see the base of palaces here when we do not see those in any of the other South Indian dynasties of the Hoysalas, of the Kakatiyas, of the Cholas, of the Pandyas, of the Pallavas? Why do we not see them? The reason is because those were mainly constructed out of perishable material, out of brick and out of wood. Whereas over here, for the first time, stone came into being. So excavations have revealed the palace of Harihara II, known as Veera Harihara, ruled between 1377 and 1404, identified because of an inscription. And foreign travelers also tell us about royal courts, royal residences, gardens, water supply, and in some of the palaces, platforms to get onto the backs of elephants, etc. So these are the base of some of the palaces. Each king had a palace, and many of the remains of them can be seen. Madhura Vijayam of Ganga Devi also mentions the palaces. I won't read the verse, but I'll just read the translation. She says, the elevated portions of the city had high-built palaces, which were white like the clouds of autumn reaching to the skies. So here is the base of Harihara's palace. Very extensive, and a map of Hampi. We'll never ever be done without seeing a portrait of Krishnadevaraya in metal. This is not in Hampi, but this is in the Tirumala temple, the Venkateshwara temple, of his great contribution to this empire and to this temple in particular, because he was such a great ardent devotee of Venkateshwara, of Tirumala Raya, later kings. So the sun, I've taken this from the net, the sun set over Hampi in 1565. Great, great city came to an end. And how did it all end? Because after Krishnadevaraya came his half-brother Achyutaraya. After Achyutaraya came his nephew Sadashivaraya, who was a puppet in the hands of Krishnadevaraya's son-in-law Ramaraya. Ramaraya was virtually ruling this kingdom, very powerful but also very haughty. And he interfered in the affairs of the Deccani sultans, and all of them joined together, and four of them, save Behrer, advanced on to fight with Vijayanagara. They met at the fateful battle of Talikota, which is about a village about 7 kilometers from Hampi, and the battle was fought. The Vijayanagara army was far more formidable, far more powerful, far bigger than that of the Deccani sultans. However, because of very many reasons, including Ramaraya's own problems as an army general, this war was lost by Vijayanagar. And Ramaraya was killed on the battlefield. It is said that the enemies picked him up in the tusks of the elephant and took him to the enemy camp, and he was beheaded. Thus fell one of the most powerful rulers of Hampi. Though not actual king, he was ruling over a very powerful empire. He was himself a very strong king. And with that, the enemy forces chased the Vijayanagara hapless army into the city of Vijayanagara. And from the accounts of 1567, which the Italian traveler has left for us, Hampi was plundered, looted, desecrated, ransacked for 6 months. There were treasures. Sadashivaraya and Thirumala, another person of the royal family, left Vijayanagar and they fled to Penukonda in Andhra Pradesh, where they had a fort. And they were very safely over there. The death of Sadashivaraya marked the end of the Thuluva dynasty, and after that, the Aravidu dynasty took over. They were ruling from Penukonda, and that was when Thirumala tried to re-establish Hampi as the capital, but unfortunately, that did not happen. And Thirumala, who was a brother of Ramaraya, crowned himself as the king in Penukonda, and thus began the Aravidu line. They did not accept Virupaksha as the family deity, and it was Thiruvenkatanatha, Srinivasa of Thirumala, who became their family deity. And then things started becoming difficult in Penukonda. The capital was shifted to Chandragiri near Tirupati, where also they had a fort and a palace. There were a number of kings of the Aravidu dynasty, like Sri Ranga the First, Venkata the Second, Venkata the Third, Sri Rangaraya the Third, etc. The Nayaks, who were the feudatories of the Vijayanagara kings, became very, very powerful. They slowly became independent, refused to give their support to the last few Vijayanagara kings. The final blow came from the Sultan of Bijapur, who invaded the south, and Sri Ranga had to seek refuge in Mysore. And this brought about an end, complete end to the Vijayanagara Empire. The end of Hampi was not the end of Vijayanagara. But then I hasten to add, Hampi will never end. Hampi is still there, very much throbbing with life. You walk into the ruins of the palaces, the ruins of the temples, you walk into any part of Hampi and you can visualize the glory in which it was in the 14th, 15th, 16th centuries. I'll stop with just saying a few more things, but for the Vijayanagara Empire. But for them standing as a barricade along the banks of the Tungabhadra, but for them, South India would have been invaded, plundered, and ransacked many, many times by various kings from North India. Her culture would not have been intact. The dance and music would not have been the same. Those glorious temples of the kings of the eras before Vijayanagara, the Hoysalas, the Kakatiyas, the Cholas, Pandyas, Pallavas, name them, would not have been standing erect and tall today, inviting us into their compounds. Much of what we have in the south would not have happened, but for Vijayanagar. And it is a homage that we have to pay to the kings, their soldiers, their ministers, the people of the Vijayanagara era. We have to do this day after day, every day, if we value the culture and the tradition of South India that we have with us today. Thank you very much.
Wonderful. Thank you, Dr. Chitra Madhavan, for an excellent lecture. I know it's, you know, you can never do justice to such a huge topic, but I believe you have done a wonderful job. As a lot of people have remarked in the YouTube discussion, you have in fact taken us on a virtual tour of Hampi specifically, while providing a lot of information about the overall Vijayanagara rule, both its rise briefly and also the fall, which is unfortunate. But these things do happen in the history, the rise and fall of various empires. Now, depending upon the time you have, I have quite a few questions that the viewers have asked. So let me start by asking you, you yourself mentioned along the way that the workmanship is poor, but these are all sculptures that are important. Any reason why you think the workmanship is relatively poor? I mean, I'm not saying that's the case with Vijayanagara sculptures overall. There are outstanding sculptures across the board. But compared to any of the earlier dynasties, you know, if you take Tamil Nadu, the Pallavas, the Cholas, then you take the Hoysalas, the compared to that, of course, the Chalukyas, what do you think is the reason?
I, for one, I used to compare sculptures of different eras.
Okay.
And then I realized that I shouldn't, because we should look at the cultural scene in relation to the political scene. And we understand that when the Pallavas and the Chalukyas and all other dynasties were there in South India, it was completely different from the scenario of the Vijayanagara times. They were there for a purpose, to prevent invasions from coming into South India and to give South India a certain stability, a certain political stability and economic prosperity. And this they did to the best of their ability. For that one reason, maybe sculpture took a step back. Something disappeared. That much I will tell you. I am not for a second berating Vijayanagara sculpture, but the life that was infused into a bronze or into a stone image of the Pallava, Pandya, Chalukya, Chola, Chimes is not there in Vijayanagara. I will not be able to pinpoint that one reason, but the yeoman service they have done to iconography in bronze and in stone stamps. And if we, not only in Hampi, if we go to temples like Lepakshi and Tadapatri, in Tadapatri, the Ramayana saints, they are nothing. In fact, the Hazara Ram temple is very simple compared to what we have in Tadapatri. It's so intricate, and so many small episodes from the Ramayana have been introduced over there. It's completely amazing. So if we are looking only at the form, maybe we don't get what we expect after having seen Chola masterpieces. But many other things were introduced, like the narrative sculptures, which were not there in the previous eras.
Absolutely. And the grand size, the numbers from one end to the other end of South India, if you could take it. Wherever you go, you cannot today miss the Vijayanagara architecture and the subsequent Nayak architecture, without doubt.
Complete.
Yeah. So I will show some questions. So here is a question from Viru Giri. Apart from foreign travelers' chronicles, which mention roses as being in opulent use by commoners and aristocrats, do any inscriptions mention roses? What do you ask?
I'm afraid I don't know the answer to this, but I would doubt if they were mentioned in inscriptions. I doubt it, but I am not fully in the know. That's an honest answer.
Okay. So when we talked about the spread of Vijayanagara Empire, there is a question that it's the empire also is connected, therefore, to the architecture. So Venkatesh wants to know why there is no influence of Vijayanagara kings in Kerala.
Kerala was hardly ever conquered, except by the Cholas to a certain extent. And that too only for a short period. And after that, it went back to the rulers of Kerala. Vijayanagara kings also in the reign of Achyutaraya did win decisive battles in Kerala. First of all, that. Secondly, the architecture of Kerala is very different from the architecture of the rest of South India. Much stone is not used over there at all. It's mostly the tile and the timber tradition. And the Vijayanagara architecture being totally dependent on stone, you hardly find it over there. But yes, in some parts of Kerala, like in the Padmanabhaswamy temple and even in the Padmanabhapuram palace, you have those typical Pushpa Godigai, that is pillars with the inverted plant and leaf motif. It's there. it's definitely there. Either it's Vijayanagara or it's post Vijayanagara. But the impact of Vijayanagara on Kerala is very limited, just like the influence of the Cholas on Kerala is also very limited, whereas you can find their influence in other parts of South India.
So I don't know whether this question is correct, but nevertheless, Muniyalappa wants to know, most of the monuments that is in Hampi damaged are Vaishnava temples. Can you throw light on this? I thought the damage was sort of uniform right across.
It is uniform, but many more Vaishnava temples perhaps or sculptures perhaps have been damaged. But see, the Ganesha is also damaged, the Nandi is also damaged, many Shiva temples have also been damaged. There are Vishnu temples that have not been damaged as well. But there are some people who have also attributed to it this to a post 1565, post Talikota thing. And that this happened because of some anti-Vaishnavite elements, but I don't want to put my finger on this.
Okay. Manish Shetty wants to know, because you mentioned the connection of Kishkindha to Hampi, are there any archaeological sources to confirm this?
Archaeological sources, I don't think are possible from the Ramayana times, whose date is still a matter of great controversy. But literary sources, and I repeat, local tradition, this cannot be removed. Nowhere else, you see, Rama traversed a huge path starting from Ayodhya and then down to Lanka. He traveled over very many paths, according to the Valmiki Ramayana. And this author, Valmiki, was obviously very conversant with the flora and fauna of different regions in India. It tallies, and works, research has been done on that also. So if you go by that and by the description of the present-day Hampi in Valmiki Ramayana, that is the Kishkindha of that chapter, everything kind of falls into place. Whereas in India, do you have Sugriva's cave, or where do you have the Dundubi, who was the carcass that was kicked by Bali, Matanga Maharishi's ashram? Everything over here echoes from Kishkindha. And we have to take it with the literary evidence, no archaeological sources.
Okay. Meshna Rao's question is, I think he refers to the Hazara Rama temple, I think. When was it restored and opened to public?
I'm not aware of the exact date when it was restored, but the ASI has done an absolutely splendid job in putting this temple together. And then we can view the Ramayana sculptures on the walls. It was, we understand, in a very ruined condition. I don't know the exact date.
When we visited there, it was raining heavily. Suddenly, the rains picked up, and it was really great in that, you know, against the granite, with water falling on it, the whole, the bas-relief really came to life. The contrast really, it was an amazing experience going through identifying the panels. I think it's something that we should take all our children to, read them the story and take them there to make them identify the scenes from Ramayana.
No, sir. Where else can you see a Kabanda or a Shravan Kumar?
Yeah. Phenomenal. Yes, absolutely. So there are a couple of questions from Rajgopal Tupul, both are sort of related. A word or two about Vijayanagara's dynasty with respect to Srirangam and Swami Vedanta Desika.
All right. So, what happened was, when Ulugh Khan invaded South India and the army barged into the island, the very peaceful island of Srirangam, many people were massacred and some people fled. One of those people who did was Sri Vedanta Desika. And he is known to have gone through Srimangalam and to the Karnataka area, to Melkot, etc. And there he stayed in his very long life. And it is said that at a very ripe age of 99, knowing that Gopanna, who was the governor of Senji, had and was under Kumara Kampanna, had reopened the Srirangam temple, having brought the images of Ranganatha and Sri Devi and Bhudevi, who were there hidden in the hidden as in kept in for safety in the Tirumala temple. Gopanna had brought them to Senji, done aradhana for them there, and then evicted the Muslim governor from Srirangam, opened the temple for worship, brought the deities, reconsecrated them, and that was the great news of Gopanna. At hearing of this, Vedanta Deshika is supposed to have hurried back to Srirangam for that consecration, and there he sang a verse, composed a verse, Aniya Anila Shringa Dyuti Rachita, it's a verse, that is found etched on the wall of the second prakaram of this temple. It is known from the literary sources of the Vaishnavas also. So that was when Vedanta Deshika returned to Srirangam to see the grand reconsecration of this temple in the reign of Kumarakampana, in the time of Kumarakampana.
Okay. There's another question from Rajagopal again. Any points on Vijayanagara's contribution towards Ahobilam?
Yes. There are literary sources which tell us that in the time of, I'm not able to recollect, either Sadashivaraya or when Ramaraya was ruling at the time of Sadashivaraya, the sultans of Bijapur were giving some kind of trouble to the Ahobilam area. So the jeer or the pontiff of the Ahobilam madam sent word to Vijayanagar asking them to come and help and protect this area. The king himself was to come when this pontiff had a dream, a divine dream, saying that the king himself should not leave the capital and come to Ahobilam. So the king sent two of his trusted army general who protected this area, chased away the enemies, and they were given a lot of, they were honored by the Ahobilam madam. They and their families were honored. So this is one literary reference we have.
Okay. There are many questions, so I will, how much time do we have? Maybe in another 10 minutes we can take?
I have all the time.
Okay. Okay, then I will as well ask you all the questions. This is from Anuradha. Any reason for naming the Ganeshas after groundnuts and mustard seeds?
That's a local thing.
Anything to do with the, you know, the fields around that, or just a local lore?
It's a local thing. It's a local thing.
Okay. There is a question from Venkatesh. Let's see, one second. Here it is. Did Vijayanagara kings try to replicate temples across South India in Hampi, such as, for example, Bhagadeeswara or anything else that they had seen? Or is it completely their own idea and design?
I would not use the word replicate. I would only use the word using that type of architecture that was in vogue in Tamil Nadu even prior to the Vijayanagara times. Because the stone, I repeat, granite that is found in abundance in Hampi is very suitable for the Dravidian style of architecture. They didn't try to replicate any particular temple model, not Brihadeshwara, not at all. It was just that style of architecture that they used. And even to a complex like Virupaksha that was already there prior to 1336, that is the formation of the Vijayanagara kingdom, the mantapas that were added and the gopuras that were added in front are according to this style of architecture only.
Okay. So there are more questions. One from Srileka Rajesh. Are there any evidence of any of these structures having been painted at any time period?
Good question. Most temples were painted, that's for sure. It's an academic prescription. Most temples were painted. Today, because of the state in which Hampi is, it is definitely a ruined paradise. So when we hardly get to see any of the structures being fully there, except for a few temples, very unlikely that we get to see fragments or traces of paintings, because many of these temples were burnt. Much activity happened during 1565. Post 1565, there was so much neglect. It was neglect. It was overgrown. It was, it was completely overgrown. And even that foreign traveler who came in 1567 mentions that there were wild animals and all of that. So it's difficult to see traces of paintings in a place that has been so badly ignored and which has gone through so much trauma.
Okay. This one persistent question from one particular viewer, from Harish Prasad, he says, of course, complimenting your presentation, what is the influence of coastal Karnataka during this period? I take it coastal Karnataka, Vijayanagara rulers' influence on coastal Karnataka, or the rivers, I don't know, but I hope you can...
Even I don't understand that question, but why should that be something in particular? The Goa region was under the Portuguese. Krishnadevaraya did have a couple of skirmishes with the Portuguese. But then, in view of the fact that the horses were needed for his army, they were pretty much on cordial terms. I don't know which part of coastal Karnataka you mean in particular, but I don't have any specific answer for that.
Okay. This is also a question that was repeatedly asked by Vellanki or Vellanki Vidwat. Who is Tungabhadra? Is it a human or any incarnation of any god? I think the rivers, are they seen as incarnation of somebody, a god, or just a name, perhaps the etymology of that particular word?
So Tunga and Bhadra, two rivers coming together make the Tungabhadra, basically. So, in India, we do revere the rivers as goddesses. There's absolutely no doubt about that. Like the Ganga, the Yamuna, the Kaveri, who is also found as images in some temples in the Kumbakonam area. If that is, I don't understand your question fully, but it's not a goddess who became a river, that in tradition perhaps, but we revere our rivers as goddesses, for sure.
Okay. Question from Shankar Ram. Could you please tell us about the influence of Badami and Aihole and the ancient Ravana temple worship present there? I think he is talking about the cave called in Aihole, Ravanapadi. So I don't think it is. Yeah.
There's cave. There's a cave in Aihole belonging to the 6th century. It's a Shiva cave. It's called the Ravanapadi cave today. Nothing in particular to do with Ravana. There isn't even a sculpture of Ravana over there. I'm not aware of any Ravana worship having happened in the Chalukyan times.
Okay. Question from Nivedita Ratnam. What information is inscribed on the copper plates? Seems like we only have the foreign travelers' documentation. Any such info on the copper plates?
The copper plate inscriptions are a treasure house of information. But the Vijayanagara copper plates are not vastly different from those of their predecessors. In size, yes, and in numbers, yes, because it was such a vast empire. Basically, these copper plate inscriptions talk about donations. The first part is called the Prashasti or the introduction, and it gives you the genealogy of the kings. And then there is the actual operative part of the inscription that talks about a land donation or some such donation to scholars or to temples. Now, you get a number of, a lot of information, not only about the kings, their wars, their conquests, etc. You also get information about different officials involved in the administration. You get titles. You understand how the borders of the villages were actually measured for measures, for currency, for various other things, social, economic, cultural, political history, all of that comes from the copper plate inscriptions. And they go on to corroborate and support evidence that we get from other sources also. Sometimes they give us information that are not found in other sources. They are invaluable, are these copper plate inscriptions. Also, the development of language, development of script, all that we get from stone and copper plate inscriptions.
Okay. Now, I think if I can interpret that question, I think one of the problems we have is that the Western accounts are narrative accounts, detailed, story-like, when they are describing a particular event. Right? Whereas the inscriptional evidence that we have, be it in stone or in copper plates, perhaps the purpose is different, which is land grant or something like that. The stone inscriptions have, again, a variety of purposes. But I guess these narrative accounts that are basically pen to paper kind of a model of describing an event, of all the foreign travelers that you talk about, even the not only in the Vijayanagara times, but let's say the Chinese travelers who have come to India and have gone back and written accounts of it. I guess today, where we are, I think that is a question that is coming up. Why didn't the Indians write such an account in prose form of a long letter kind of a thing? Would you have any answer to something like that? I'm just going to ask you.
Okay, so this is my interpretation. Okay. I would think that I live near Mylapore. I go to Mylapore very often, about 2-4 kilometers from my house. And I've been seeing this from childhood. It's nothing new to me. If I were to go to some land which I have never been to, and I go to Indonesia, I'm wonderstruck, you know. And then I would write back home saying, look at all these things that I saw. So for the people of the Vijayanagara times, looking at something that they had grown up with was nothing astonishing. So why should they write all that? Oh, I am seeing this Mahanavami Dibba, I am seeing this. And so it was the foreign travelers who were completely wonderstruck looking at this fantastic city called Vijayanagara. And they wrote down everything that they saw. This would be my interpretation. I may be right, I may be wrong.
If I may then play devil's advocate and ask, then didn't the Indian travelers go abroad and write something similar? In which case, you would have found.
We haven't found them, perhaps. Look, how many accounts of all the Chinese who came here have been left behind for us? We found precious little.
My personal answer to that would be that we didn't have access to paper until much later when the Europeans started coming here. And even the Europeans from Chinese, through Silk Route, paper reached them. Though it was precious, the idea of documenting it and preserving it was perhaps available to them, which Indians rather used the palm leaves and similar elements. They were primarily used for preserving, let's say, religious texts, other commentaries, dharmashastras, just documenting such things. And it was not part of, we don't even seem to have that amount of material related to trade, for example, of documenting the kind of things that are traded. I mean, to the same extent as, for example, it is available, particularly in the Silk Route, for example, equivalent, if you can sort of compare that. Maybe that is the reason, but I'm not a historian to argue here, just guessing. I have a question from Vijay. In Madurai, there is a Ramarayar Mandapam where Lord Azhagar passes through. Is that Ramarayar the same as the one from Vijayanagara?
I wouldn't know, highly unlikely. Of course, the Madurai Nayaks were very much under the Vijayanagara rulers. I shouldn't say very unlikely. I rephrase this because the Madurai Nayaks came under the Vijayanagara rulers for a long time. And it was much later that when the Vijayanagara rulers became weak, that they withdrew their support and became completely independent. But if there is a Ramaraya Mantapam, then if we know how to date it, and perhaps yes. Because Ramaraya was not a very liked figure, nor was he the king. So we have Nayak copper plate inscriptions dating it from the reign of Sadashivaraya. When Sadashivaraya was doing this, this Nayak king was ruling and he was giving a donation. So we have such copper plate inscriptions. Since Ramaraya was not the actual king, he was only ruling on behalf of Sadashivaraya, and up to Land's End, Madurai, would his name have reached, and would there be a Mandapa named after him? I don't know.
Okay. Raghav Venkatraman asks, Is there any evidence of Jainism or Jaina icons in Hampi from Vijayanagara period?
There were Jain temples in Hampi. There is still now, even now, a dilapidated Jain temple in Hampi. Jainism was very much part of the Vijayanagara Empire. Very much there. We have enough evidence for that.
I think you have already mentioned the answer to the question that's coming up. Muralidhar Subramaniam wants to know, what is the relationship of Vijayanagar with Sringeri? By which I'm talking, I think he talks about the Kanch Math, Sringeri Shankaracharya Math.
Starting from the time of Swami Vidyaranya in the 14th century, I think he was the brain behind five generations of Vijayanagara kings. And you see him in the painting in royal procession. And they were the Rajagurus of the Vijayanagara kings in succession. Very, very close connection between the Vijayanagara dynasty, as long as they were in Hampi, and the Sringeri Math. Very close connection.
Question from, just last couple of questions. One from Shivram Bharadwaj. Says, even without invasion, there are influences of one style in other places. So in Kerala, how much does the lack of this Otu type of stone found there?
Sorry, which stone?
Type of stone, such as laterite, for example. So he says, I mean, even without the invasion, is there the lack of influence, does it have to do with the type of laterite stone that is found in Kerala?
Okay, first, the question is not very clear. However, invasion only, you're right, I fully agree, concur with you, that it's not only because of invasion that a particular style of architecture has to permeate into another area. Having said that, what about this laterite stone? I don't understand. So the Vijayanagara architecture, based on the model of Dravidian architecture, did not have an impact on Kerala. And as I said earlier, nor did any other type of architecture have a great influence on Kerala. Their type of architecture for their temples is totally different. So they did not import ideas even without invasion into Kerala. It just didn't happen that way. But this laterite part, I don't understand.
The kind of stones that are used, particularly when you are going through various temples of Hampi, you talked about different stones. In fact, there's one question from one of the viewers, like, what are the types of stones used in making icons? In which, you know, you talked about chloritic schist, laterite, different stones, geological formations. Maybe, you know, he's talking about there are certain types of stones not found in Kerala, which therefore precluded a particular kind of architecture.
I wouldn't go so far as to say that. It's just that other styles of architecture didn't happen. The Cholas ruled over there for a long time. How many Chola temples do you see in Kerala today?
Right. This is a question from Nageshwar Rao. I read that there is a Thirumangai Azhvar sub shrine in Krishna temple. Is that true?
There are lots of sculptures. Most of the sanctums of the Krishna temple are empty. The Azhvar's influence in Vijayanagara was profound. We know of the Amukta Maliyada, the great work written by Krishna Devaraya based on Andal's Charitram. There are lots of sculptures of Azhvars and Sri Vaishnava Acharyas on the pillars, etc. of Hampi. So Thirumangai Azhvar, being one of the famous Azhvars, his sculptures are also there in Hampi. Huge influence of Vaishnavite lore in present-day Hampi.
Okay. Let me just come to the last question, absolutely last question, actually. Locate the name properly. It says Kumara Kampanna came to Madurai to save Madurai. Whereas recent research papers in Tamil Nadu talks about
I can't hear you, I'm sorry. I'm not able to hear. Sorry, I'm unable to hear.
I think I crashed out. I don't know whether.
I didn't hear you at all. Completely cut off.
No, no. I was asking about a question on Kumara Kampanna. I don't know whether you.
I heard the first few lines and then it got cut.
Okay. No, no. The question is, he says someone pointed out. The name of the person is not clearly there in the screenshot. But that there is some recent research papers in Tamil Nadu saying that Kumara Kampanna invaded Tamil Nadu, whereas it's that he came to Madurai to save Madurai. What do you think of such research?
Okay, so Kumara Kampanna was stationed by his father Bukka the Second in Tamil Nadu as one of the governors of one of the provinces. Like many of his sons were sent to many of the other provinces. And Bukka sent word to Kumara Kampanna to defeat the Sultan of Madurai. And Kampanna set forth and accomplished that task and brought virtually the whole of Tamil Nadu under the control of the Vijayanagara Empire. Now, how about invasion of Tamil Nadu? I don't understand, because when parts of Tamil Nadu were already under the Vijayanagara Empire, and in their attempt to bring the whole of Tamil Nadu, whole of South India, in fact, under the banner of Vijayanagara, invasion of Tamil Nadu from that time 500 years ago, more than 500 years ago, not sure whether that's the right way to say.
Yeah, I think it comes from the ideas of linguistic nationalism. Because all these kings were invading one another in a sense, and the boundaries were not that clearly delineated.
We never had the boundaries like we have today. So I don't think we can look at the past from the perspective of the present. It wouldn't be good to do that.
And absolutely, absolutely final question. This is from Balaji Thattapani. Were the Vijayanagara rulers Kannada speaking or Telugu speaking?
This is somewhat. So Krishnadevaraya wrote in Telugu. Many of the poet composers were also wrote in Telugu. Kannada was the medium of many of the inscriptions that are found in Hampi and other places. I'm not sure whether there's a definite answer to this.
Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Chitra Madhavan, for an wonderful lecture and your patience in taking up all the questions and answering them. There were many more questions, but we really have run out of time. Thank you once again for your wonderful lecture. From Tamil Heritage Trust, we thank all the viewers who are also present in large numbers in this live stream. Thank you once again, and we will meet again in the month of February for our monthly lecture. Thank you.
Pleasure being with all of you, and many thanks to Tamil Heritage Trust and to the very patient audience. Thank you very much.
Thank you.